How's it going, everybody? Back for another update. Real quick, I want to say I appreciate all the responses and messages I got on the last video. I still haven't made up my mind on which way I'm going to go, if I'm going to change anything or leave it the same. I don't know yet. I'm still working it out. So for now, this should be an on-schedule video. I'm making it a little early, but we'll see when I put it up. So, oh yeah, also if my voice is a little off, I was a little under the weather for a while, so, and I'm still getting over that, as you can probably hear, so forgive that, but I want to do an update anyway. So we're going to start with what is personally a big one again, this time out, real, I like this one. It is, what is it? It's zombie creeping flesh. No, wait, it's virus. Okay, well actually, no, hold on 1 second here. Oh, it is zombie creeping flesh. Oh, wait, no. Nope, it's Night of the Zombies. I've always loved that particular art, so I'm glad that, wait, oh, look at that, wait. No, oh, it's Class of Nukem High? No, it's virus. Okay, oh wait, nope, it's zombie creeping flesh. Well, oh wait, you get the idea. This is a movie with a lot of titles, all right. But as confusing as multi-title movies can be, and by the way, what happened to Hell of the Living Dead? Oh, nothing. You get that title when you put the disc in. And here we are with another problematic slipcase. Whatever title you know it under. Here it is. And here it is. This is it. It's on Blu-ray from 88 Films in this beautifully presented edition. I mean, take a good look at that. That is some quality art. These things, these covers have a strange feel to them. They're unique. And I like how they look. Their slipcover game is on fire. I can't even say anything bad about them, that's for sure. I've mentioned it before, I used to not care barely at all. Once in a while there'd be exceptions, a slipcover I really wanted, but God, I'm loving these. That is just incredible. And I loved opening it up to see that Night of the Zombies title art on the booklet. And I also love having the Hell of the Living Dead title on screen. It's all great. It's a wonderful presentation of a movie that still gets picked on, but that I still defend. Yes, it's... appropriations, let's call them, are shameless, but I mean that in a good way. It completely without shame. Like, I don't know how, Bruno Mattei was not ashamed, okay? And I am not ashamed to love it. And I feel like it's gaining ground as the years roll on. I think that's a good thing. I love the concept of the movie, the idea behind everything, which I won't say just in case anybody out there is new to the movie, but I do enjoy the idea of it. I love the use of the Dawn of the Dead soundtrack and scene, you know, inspirations, as well as the Contamination soundtrack and even the Beyond the Darkness soundtrack. Yeah, so, and I love that this was the beginning of Vincent Dawn, which I get a huge kick out of to this day. This is a tremendous movie with a feeling that is definitely uniquely its own, even if many of the scenes and situations are not uniquely its own. There is something really special about this movie. Think of it like, okay, this movie's like your favorite blanket. It might not be in the best shape compared to other blankets. It might be a little tattered and scrappy looking and showing some wear. But once you get wrapped up in it, you just don't care because it's perfect for you. Or me, in this case. Can you feel it? Can you feel the affection? Yes, a lot of the movies I defend so vehemently, like Deadly Spawn, Burial Ground, Xtro, Madman, The Mutilator, Ator, The Slayer, Pieces, all those and all the rest, they all come from a certain time in my life and all impacted me in different important ways. This is another one. So I'm always going to be there with a positive word for this bad boy. And that's it. I'm really not talking about the movie too much because I just wanted to, or at least not about the plot, I just wanted to talk about the release. I wanted to talk about how much of a fan I am. Anyway, okay. It does have a lot of extras, of course. Besides all the cover options and booklet you saw, you have the option to watch in English or Italian with English subtitles that are for the Italian dialogue. They aren't dub titles. You get a 22-minute interview with Margie Newton, which is great, new. A 26-minute interview segment with Claudio Fragasso and Rosella Drudi, and the theatrical trailer, which is pushing 4 minutes by itself. All those interviews are new, for the record. The question everybody who doesn't have it is probably asking right now, is it an upgrade? That, my friends, that's a tough one. A lot of it's gonna be subjective in the end, I think. I'll put it like this. I'm glad I don't have to write a comparative piece about it, and I respect those who are doing it and can do it because it's a tough job. Now, on a personal level, I think I prefer the 88 version, but that is not to say that the Blue Underground version is bad, because it isn't. But there are differences, minor differences, and I'm going to leave it to the people currently toiling away to deliver those details to, you know, go ahead and do so. Shortest version possible. I am not sorry about this. The BU disc still has value with its unique extras and, of course, you know, rats. Yeah, and there you have it. Vincent Donn's classic 1980 zombie splatter epic, complete with social message and an undeniably beautiful release. It's Region B locked, and it's on Blu-ray from 88 Films. Or this. And it's Kino time once again. The Destructors on Blu-ray from Kino Lorber. Another I was waiting for a sale on, and thanks to Kino's big clear out recently, that wait was rewarded, and so of course I grabbed it, and many others, so don't be surprised to see a steady influx of Kino throughout updates as I go. But The Destructors, also known as The Marseille Contract, as you can see there, is a 1974 action crime thriller that stars Anthony Quinn, Michael Caine, and James Mason in the leads. But they are far from all the recognizable people that show up, especially if you watch a lot of French movies. In particular, you'll see Marcel Bozoufi, for example, and Maureen Kerwin is another. It's a very solid cast, and it was directed by Robert Parrish, who was a real chameleon of a director. I'm saying, this guy, I don't think there was a type of film he wasn't up to handling and handling well. But okay, in this one, Quinn is the head of the Paris office of the DEA, and he knows that James Mason is the head of all the drug trade in a massive area, Marseille in particular. He won't let Mason's character alone, and soon some attempts are being made on his life. Well, frustrated, victimized, locked up in red tape, procedure and orders and all that garbage, and with a fiery hatred of his own desk, he takes matters into his own hands by deciding to take out a contract on Mason's life. The hitman is an old friend of Quinn's. He doesn't know that at first, but it turns out to be an old friend who's played by Michael Caine. And from there we go. Guns, car chases, suspense, tension, double crosses, turnarounds, and we even have time for the ladies. Everybody paints an interesting picture here, but Caine, Michael Caine, in particular, gives us something really special. It's a fun-loving and charming hitman who, for the right price, will turn cold-blooded on a snap. It's fascinating. The cinematography is atmospheric and nice. The locations are, of course, beautiful, and the soundtrack is excellent. That's from Roy Budd, who had a real talent for exactly this kind of soundtrack. Love it. Also, it's yet another that I only knew from distant, fuzzy, full-screen memory. So, seeing it like this after all this time, it's beautiful. So great. Oh, check this out. The inside. Usually there's not much to see, but as you can see, the poster art's on the inside. For The Destructors. I don't know how this is going to work, but it's in there. For your perusal and enjoyment. Yeah. So I do recommend the movie, obviously. Excellent 70s toughness and badassery abounds. Amazing characters at odds with everything around them and often themselves. And an ending that just, it hit me. I really, really enjoy this movie. If you're a 70s film fan, check it out. This is definitely for you. At least, it's very definitely for me. Comes with a couple of trailers, as always, and that poster on the inside, which is cool. I liked seeing that. Kino strikes again. I love it. The Marseille contract, better known as the Destructors. Sticking hard with the Kino Lorber Blu-ray releases, this is I, the Jury. Let's talk about I, the Jury. All right, just a little bit. I almost decided to skip showing this altogether because I thought by the time I was done, I'd have caused more confusion than anything else, and it wouldn't be the first time, right? Then, when I realized it wouldn't be the first time, I figured, what the heck? I'd do that anyway, so why not? Okay, copyright 1981, released in 1982 by 20th Century Fox. This was a movie that seemed doomed from the get-go. Larry Cohen wrote it and originally started to direct it. He was the director. He was removed as director about a week in, and Richard T. Heffron was brought in to straighten things out or get things back on track or whatever phrase they were using at the time. It's Armand Assante taking the role of Mike Hammer in a story loosely based on Mickey Splaine's original crime novel of the late 40s. It had already been a movie of the same name in the early 50s. It's good stuff, by the way. And there are some similarities, a lot of similarities, actually. But there are also some important differences. More on that later in the ramble. All right. This is set in modern New York City. And it's filled to bursting with violence, graphic sex, nudity, sleazy situations, and a heavy post-Vietnam vibe. And I like that, though, as you guys know, I've spoken on that before. So Hammer's friend is murdered, and Hammer, being a private eye, decides to, look into it. He has a couple cops on his side. He has his secretary, Velda, played by Loreen Landon, and he's got some fish. To keep him sane, he likes his fish. All right, the trail he follows starts to stink a little bit, and he learns what he's supposed to learn for a little while, and then he learns what he isn't supposed to learn. And beyond that, yeah, it's time to, drop the hammer, I guess. Some cast on this one: Barbara Carrera as the sultry and mysterious Dr. Charlotte. Jeffrey Lewis shows up as a drunk old friend with an important truck. Paul Sorvino is the detective. Alan King is a gangster. Lynette and Leanne Harris show up as the twins, and this was, I think, right before Sorceress came out. It's right around the same time. A lot of other faces in the cast as well. Outstanding soundtrack. That's from Bill Conti, so no fails there. And the bloody effects were done by Carl Fullerton. Now, when this landed, the critics ravaged it. All right. They absolutely tore it to pieces. And word of mouth turned sour really quickly. The movie failed. The original plan was to have a series, but yeah, that didn't turn out so well. They said it was about nothing more than graphic sex and graphic violence and that this was no noir. Well, duh, but okay. They said it was too far removed from the original material with its sex clinic angle and government conspiracies and all the other stuff they added. They said Hammer was played all wrong. And they said a lot more than that. You can find most of it online now. It's amazing how many ways they tore into it. Now, I get everything they all said. I fully understand all the points they made about why they didn't like it. The thing is, all those points they made are why I did like it. All right, I saw it young enough that this was it. I didn't know about the books or the other movies or any of that. I knew this, and that's probably what helped me. I don't know, but I've always enjoyed it. No, Hammer is no angry alcoholic with a Hulk-like dysfunctional personality to him. Well, not the same kind of dysfunctional personality. This hammer is a bastard, though, still. And that's clear from the first few minutes. Morality is sort of a gray area for him, okay? Especially when it comes to sex and the women. And yes, the sleaze is amped up. But for anybody else who has read the book, what's the problem? You know what I'm saying? I mean, that was all... There were some lurid things going on to begin with, weren't there? And the 50s movie had some of that as well, as much as it could. It made up for the rest by being, you know, and correct me if I'm wrong, please, the only 3D film noir. That was the angle on that one. Weird idea, though. Anyway, I get why some people didn't and wouldn't like this, but there's an imbalance there. And I think that was caused by what people were used to seeing in movies based on Splane's work. This must have been a shocker. Different time, different attitude, same situations for the most part, but shuffled into a new kind of in-your-face presentation. So, yeah, good tough action with, let's say, more of what you came for. Let's put it that way. I enjoy it, but I completely respect the opinions of anybody who says they don't. I always try to anyway, but here it actually makes more sense to me than usual. Either jury. I like it. I recommend it. If you're curious at this point, or if you've seen the trailer and it looks good to you, you probably will enjoy it. All right? It's on Blu-ray from Kino, of course. I can't begin to tell you how tempting it is to just keep going with the Kinos. But as stacked up as they are, that got me thinking about how the Shaw Brothers have also... Those movies have become their own little section at this point of two show titles. And so I've got to start working those in once again. With that in mind, here it is. 1968's The Bells of Death. Directed by Yue Feng. I first saw this way back in the day on a VHS from Southgate Entertainment. And I remember that tape being letterboxed as well. I could be mistaken, but I really do remember it that way. If it was... It was one of, if not the, very first U.S. tape I saw that was letterboxed. Anyway, that was stolen from me some years back, so no way to check. Please, tape collectors, let me know if I'm right or wrong on that. Anyway, the image disc eventually came out, and oddly, it was one of the few Shaw Brothers image discs that I didn't pick up. Probably because I was bitter about it being stolen or some nonsense like that. I've talked about that before. When I finally decided I wanted it again, which is easy to understand with me watching all these Shaw movies recently and knowing how great this one is anyway, I went looking for the image disc, but found this IVO release available cheaply and, yeah, well, I was collecting them anyway. It was right there. It seemed like it was meant to be, so yeah, I grabbed it. Backstory aplenty once again, sorry. So this is an Eastern Western, all right, big time. It has that aesthetic about it, and clearly with good reason, as it is essentially a Chinese retelling of Nevada Smith, the Steve McQueen movie from a few years before this. It definitely has its fans, so the less I say about that one, the better. But Bells is definitely based on that. This, however, is fantastic to me. Chang Yi stars, and I'm definitely becoming more and more of a fan of his as time goes on. I showed Silver Fox recently, right? I sure hope so, because I'm now referencing it. But yeah, I know I showed that. I'm pretty sure I showed that. He was the star of that, so I must have talked about him then, as well as many others. And yeah, I'm really starting to like the guy anyway. He starts as a simple man whose family is slaughtered by three evil bandits looking for trouble. Except for his sister. There's no sign of her anywhere. He comes across a master chivalrous swordsman, and of course some time passes. 5 years pass, in fact, and when we see him again, he's still obsessed with avenging his family and finding out what happened to his sister, but now he has the deadly skills to back up those desires for revenge. Okay. And so it goes. Early on, he saves and... eventually avenges the lovely Qin Ping, who is then glued to him for the rest of the running time. This is an outstanding movie from top to bottom. The cinematography and it's got this look. It's a treat, and the attention to that cinematography really pays off huge dividends in terms of the look and atmosphere, and some stunning confrontations also. Very nice. Lots of location shooting used to maximum effect, and a great cast. Aside from those I mentioned, you also get Ku Feng and many others. If you pay close enough attention, you'll even spot Wu Ma and Sammo Hung in very small roles. Excellent movie. Bloody, engaging, and in my opinion, leaps and bounds better than the movie that inspired it. At the very least, it was much more appropriately cast, okay? Bonus points, too, for this movie. Okay, the makeup on one of the villains. I don't know. They do some stuff to him to try and make him look like Carl Malden from the other film. And when you see that putty nose built on the guy's face and realize what they were going for, it's hard not to have a big smile on your face about it. But you forget all that quick. That guy is entirely evil, very bloodthirsty. A bit of a mental case as well, I think. So, yeah. Highly recommended Shaw Brothers Badassery here. Check it out however you want, because you've got some options, but do check it out. The usual stuff here on the disc. It's a Region 3 IVL disc containing the extras you are used to in the way of cast bios, production notes, photo gallery. They have the selectable original poster that's in the extras, the trailer and trailers for other Shaw movies, all the stuff they usually include, anamorphic. Yeah, no complaints at all. It's Bells of Death. After a cough drop and juice break, I've moved some things around again. I've decided we're not done with Kino. I have another Kino title, which also happens to be another Michael Caine title. And so I thought it belonged more in this update than a later one. So, move things around, and here it is. The Holcroft Covenant on Blu-ray from, as I said, Kino Lorber. Starring Michael Caine and directed by John Frankenheimer in 1985. It's the story of a deal, a pact, that is made during the waning days of World War II, a deal that, over time, will endow the children of three high-ranking Nazi officers with $4.5 billion. Money, it's said, that will be used to make the world a better place. To help correct some of the wrongs these three officers were responsible for, which, as it turns out, was significant, okay? Caine is the son of the main officer and is therefore meant to be chairman of the fund, the guy in charge of everything with the final say. But everything must be... The other two kids would be advisors, but the pact, the covenant, has to be signed by Caine as well as the other two children. Caine's character did not know his father. His mother took him away, realizing, if I can oversimplify it a bit, that Nazis are bad, okay? So she left, took him away. The other two need to be tracked down, but there's a lot of dogs in this fight, a lot, all right? Some people want to stop him from signing. Some people want to protect him so he can sign. And others, well, you just have to see it for yourself. Victoria Tennant is the female lead. Lily Palmer plays Caine's mother, and even Mario Adorf shows up as a world-renowned conductor, all right? So this movie, like so many I show, has taken a fair amount of crap since it was first released. As is usually the case, I'm here to act for the defense, okay? Firstly, I'm just going to knock this out of the way. I will not even begin to entertain a discussion about John Frankenheimer being a bad director. It's ridiculous to me to say that. He had ups and downs, but please, lots of directors did. Stop it, all right? Secondly, I will not even begin to entertain a discussion about Michael Caine being a bad actor. His longevity and success speak for themselves, and that is also ridiculous, so that's out. Opinions are opinions, I get that, but mine is that he's a fine actor, and he's proven it again and again, decade after decade. Maybe you can name a bad movie he's been in. Okay. Well, then I can come back with a great one. You know what I mean? He has said almost outright that some roles he just took for the money. But that doesn't make him a bad actor. That just means he was in some not so great movies, okay? It's opinions. It's all opinions. Now, it's true that this was based on a highly successful and complex mega novel by Robert Ludlum. Some 600 pages of complex novel. That's a lot. But that instantly means that this is a bad movie? No. Of course it doesn't. That's silly. All right? I like this movie. I like almost everything about it. I like how it gets less and less subtly twisted and touches on some pretty intense and shocking themes, I feel like. I like how it unfolds every minute as it goes. I like the action and I like the mystery. I enjoy the performances, and I don't think Victoria Tennant, Kane aside, gets enough credit for her work in this movie. I very much enjoy this globe-trotting adventure thriller and all the things the plot turns out to be about. I can't say more than that. I think it's a solid movie and a much stronger movie than its reputation suggests. However, I can't give it the big recommendation based on the fact that I seem to be in the bottom 5 or 10% with that opinion. It happens. Happens a lot, doesn't it? Anyway, I wanted to defend the movie a little bit, and it fits in this update well, so that's what I'm going with. Has a trailer gallery and the old commentary recorded by Frankenheimer. It's a nice release. An entertaining movie and a thrilling watch, The Holcraft Covenant on Blu-ray from Kino. I need more juice. You guys seen these? You familiar with these things? Oh, my God. It's one of the greatest inventions ever. The fidget cube. Anyway, thanks for watching the update. I actually was originally going to put some more in, but my voice is starting to go. I'm not 100% healthy yet. I just better stop. Thanks for watching. Thanks for commenting. Thanks for being subscribed. Thanks for hitting the thumbs up. Thanks for everything. And until next time, later.